Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Nimisha Jadhav from School of Studies Environmental Chemistry, Jivaji University, Gwalior. Today we are going to discuss about a module analysis of biological materials and xenobiotics under the paper of Environmental Biotechnology. The learning objective of this module included the introduction about the xenobiotic substances, then the monitoring of xenobiotics in air, water and soil, and the detailed technique used for the xenobiotic monitoring. First of all, we have to discuss, we should know about what is xenobiotic compounds. A xenobiotic species is one that is foreign to the living system. For example, heavy metals such as lead, mercury, cadmium, etc., which serves no physiological function, and the synthetic organic compounds that are not made in nature, known as xenobiotic species. The measurement of xenobiotic substances and their metabolites in blood, urine, breath, and the other samples of biological origin to determine exposure to toxic substances is called biological monitoring. It is an area in which a rapid advance are being made.
The two main approaches to workplace monitoring of toxic chemicals using samplers that sample xenobiotic substances from workplace air and biological monitoring. Although the analyses are generally much more difficult, biological monitoring is a much better indicator of exposure because phase 2 reaction product is measured. For example, sulfuric acid determined as evidence of exposure to toluene. Comparison of the levels of analytes measured with the degree and the type of exposure to foreign substances is a crucial aspect of toxicological chemistry. Some xenobiotics or their metabolites from adducts with endogenous materials in the body, which are then measured as evidence of exposure. A simple example is the adduct formed between carbon monoxide and hemoglobin, that is carboxyhemoglobin. In more complicated examples are the adducts included formation by the carcinogenic phase 1 reaction products of polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons with DNA or hemoglobin. Another class of analytes consists of endogenous substances produced upon exposure to a xenobiotic material. Methemoglobin formed as a result of exposure to nitrobenzene, aniline and related compounds is an example of such a substance which do not contain any of the original xenobiotic material. Another class of substance causes measurable alteration in enzyme activity. The most common example of this is the inhibition of acetylcholinesterase enzyme by organophosphates or carbamate insecticides. Then, we discuss about the determination of metals. In direct analysis of metals, several biologically important metals can be determined directly in body fluids, especially urine, by atomic absorption spectroscopic methods. In the simplest cases, the urine is diluted with water or with acid and a portion analyzed directly by graphite furnace atomic absorption, taking advantage of the very high sensitivity of that technique for some metals. Metals that can be determined directly in urine by this approach include chromium, copper, lead, lithium and zinc. Very low levels of metals can be measured using a graphite furnace atomic absorption technique and Zeeman background correction with a graphite furnace enables measurement of metals in samples that contain enough biological material to cause significant amounts of smoke during the atomization process so that ashing the samples is less necessary. The determination of a variety of metals in diluted blood and serum using inductively coupled plasma atomization with mass spectrometric detection. Blood was diluted tenfold and serum fivefold with a solution containing ammonia, Tritonex 100, surfactant and EDTA. The detection limits adequate for measurement in blood or serum were found for cadmium, cobalt, copper, lead, rubidium and zinc. Several toxicologically important metals are readily determined from weight, ashed blood or urine using atomic spectroscopic techniques. The ashing procedure may vary but always entails heating the sample with strong acid and oxidant to dryness and redissolving the residue in acid. A typical procedure is digestion of blood or urine for cadmium analysis, which consists of mixing the sample with a comparable volume of concentrated nitric acid, heating to a reduced volume, adding 30% hydrogen peroxide oxidant, heating to dryness and dissolving in nitric acid prior to measurement by atomic absorption or emission spectroscopy. Mixtures of nitric, sulfuric and perchloric acid are effective through somewhat hazardous media for digesting blood, urine or tissue. Weight ashing followed by atomic absorption analysis can be used for it measures exposure to all routes, oral and dermal as well as inhalation as it gives an integrated value of exposure. Furthermore, biological monitoring is very useful in determining the effectiveness of measures taken to prevent exposure, such as protective clothing and hygiene measures.
Now we discuss about the indicators of exposure to xenobiotics. The two major considerations in determining exposure to xenobiotics are the type of sample and the type of analyte. Both of these are influenced by what happened to the xenobiotic material when it gets into the body. For some exposures, the entry site composes the sample. This is the case. For example, in exposure to asbestos fibers in the air, which is manifested by the lesions of the lungs, more commonly the analyte may appear at some distance from the site of exposure, such as lead in bone that was the originally taken in by the respiratory route. In other case, the original xenobiotic is not even present in the analyte. For example, of this is the methemoglobin in blood, the result of exposure to aniline absorbed through the skin. The two major kinds of sample analyzed for xenobiotic exposures are the blood and the urine. Both of these kinds of samples are analyzed for the systemic xenobiotics, which are those that are transported in the body and metabolized in various tissues. the xenobiotic substances there and their metabolites and their adducts are absorbed into the body and transported through it in the bloodstream.
Therefore, blood is of unique importance as a sample for biological monitoring. Blood is not a simple sample to process and subjects often object to the process of taking it. Upon collection, blood may be treated with an anticoagulant using a salt of ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid, that is EDTA, and processed for analysis as whole blood. It may also be allowed to clot and be centrifuged to remove solids. The liquid remaining is blood serum. These are eliminated with the urine, making urine a good sample to analyze as evidence of exposure to xenobiotic substances. Urine has the advantage of being a simpler matrix than blood and one that subjects more readily give for analysis. Other kinds of samples that may be analyzed include breath for volatile xenobiotic and volatile metabolites, air or nails for trace elements such as selenium determination, and adipose tissue like fat, and milk obviously limited to lactating females. Various kinds of organ tissues can be analyzed in cadavers, which can be useful in trying to determine cause of death by poisoning. The choice of the analyte actually measured varies with the xenobiotic substance to which the subject has been exposed. Therefore, it is convenient to divide xenobiotic analysis on the basis of the type of chemical species determined. The most straightforward analyte is, of course, the xenobiotic itself. This applies to elemental xenobiotics, especially metals, which are almost always determined in the elemental form. In a few cases, organic xenobiotics can also be determined as the parent compound. However, organic xenobiotics are commonly metabolized to other products by phase 1 and phase 2 reactions. Commonly, the phase 1 reaction product is measured often after it is hydrolyzed from the phase 2 conjugate using enzymes or acid hydrolysis procedures. Thus, for example, transmuconic acid can be measured as evidence of exposure to the parent compound benzene. Toxic cyanide can be isolated in a special device called a Conway micro diffusion cell by treatment with acid followed by collection of the weakly acidic hydrogen cyanide gas that is evolved in a base solution. The cyanide released can be measured spectrophotometrically by formation of a colored species. Carbon monoxide is readily determined in blood by virtue of the colored carboxyhemoglobin that is forms with hemoglobin react with carbon monoxide. The procedure consists of measuring the absorbance at wavelength of 414, 421 and 428 nanometer of the blood sample. A sample through which oxygen has been bubbled to change all the hemoglobin to the oxyhemoglobin form, and a sample through which carbon monoxide has been bubbled to change all the hemoglobin to the carboxyhemoglobin. With the appropriate calculations, the percentage conversion to carboxyhemoglobin can be obtained.
Now, the determination of parent organic compounds. a number of organic compounds can be measured as the unmetabolized compound in blood, urine, and the breath. In some cases, the sample can be injected along with its water content directly into the gas chromatograph. The direct injection is used for the measurement of acetone and butanol, dimethylformamide, cyclopropane, haloethane, methoxyfuran, diethyl ether, isopropanol, methanol, methyl butyl ketone, methyl chloride, methyl ether, ketone, toluene, and many more volatile organic compounds. For the determination of volatile compounds in blood or urine, a straightforward approach is to liberate the analyte at an elevated temperature, allowing the volatile compounds to accumulate in hard space above the sample, followed by direct injection of hard space gas into the gas chromatograph. A reagent such as perchloric acid may be added to deproteinize the blood or the urine sample and facilitate release of the volatile xenobiotic compounds. Among the compounds determined by this approach are acetaldehyde, dichloromethane, chloroform, carbon tetrachloride, benzene, toluene, cyclohexane, ethylene oxide, and many more. The use of multiple detector for the gas chromatographic determination of analytes in head space increases the versatility of this technique and enable the determination of a variety of physiologically important volatile organic compounds. Purge and trap technique, in which the volatile analytes are evolved from the blood or the urine in a gas stream and collected on a trap of subsequent chromatographic analysis, has been developed. Such a technique employing gas chromatographic separation and the Fourier transform infrared detection has been described for a number of volatile organic compounds in blood.
Now we discuss about the measurement of phase 1 and phase 2 reaction products. Phase 1 reaction products: for a number of organic compounds, the most accurate indication of exposure is to be obtained by determining their phase 1 reaction products. This is because many compounds are metabolized in the body and don't show up as the parent compound. The next is the extraction of metals for atomic absorption analysis. A number of procedures for the determination of metals and biological samples call for the extraction of the metal with an organic chelating agent in order to remove interferences and concentrate the metal to enable detection of low levels. The urine or blood samples may be first subjected to weight ashing to enable extraction of the metal. Beryllium from the acid digested blood or urine sample may be extracted by acetyl acetone into methyl isobutyl ketone prior to atomic absorption analysis. Virtually all of the common metals can be determined by this approach using appropriate extractants. Next, we discuss about the determination of non-metals and inorganic compounds. Relatively few non-metals require determination in biological samples. One important example is fluoride, which occur in biological fluid as a fluoride ion. In some cases of occupational exposure or exposure through food or drinking water, excessive levels of fluoride in the body can be a health concern. Fluoride is readily determined potentiometrically with a fluoride ion selective electrode. The sample is diluted with an appropriate buffer and the potential of the fluoride electrode measured very accurately versus a reference electrode with the concentration calculated from a calibration plot. Even more accurate values can be obtained by the use of standard addition, in which the potential of the electrode system is a known volume of sample is read, a measured amount of standard fluoride is added, and the shift in potential is used to calculate the unknown concentration of fluoride. The another non-metal for which method of determining biological exposure would be useful is white phosphorus. The most common and relatively toxic elemental forms, volatile organic compounds that are not metabolized, may be readily eliminated with expired air from the lungs and may thus be missed. In cases where a significant fraction of the xenobiotic compounds has undergone a phase 2 reaction, the phase 1 product may be regenerated by acid hydrolysis. One of the compounds commonly determined as its phase. Therefore, exposure to benzene can be determined by analysis of urine for phenol. Although a very sensitive colorimetric method for phenol involving diazotized paranitroaniline has long been available, gas chromatographic analysis is now favored. The urine sample is treated with perchloric acid to hydrolyze phenol conjugates, and the phenol is extracted into diisopropyl ether for chromatographic analysis. Two other metabolic products of benzenes, transmuconic acid and S-phenyl mercapturic acid, are now commonly measured as more specific biomarkers of benzene exposure. The xenobiotics for which mercapturates may be monitored include styrene, structurally similar to toluene, acrylonitrile, allyl chloride, atrazine, butadiene, and epichlorohydrin. The formation of mercapturates or mercapturic acid derivatives by metabolism of xenobiotic is the result of phase 2 conjugation by glutathione. The glutathione, that is commonly abbreviated as GSH, is crucial conjugating agent in the body. This compound is a tripeptide, meaning that it is composed of three amino acids linked together. These amino acids are their abbreviations are glutamic acid, cysteine, and glycine.
Now we discuss about the determination of adducts. The determination of adducts is often a useful and elegant means of measuring exposure to xenobiotics. Adducts, as the name implies, are the substances produced when the xenobiotic substances add to endogenous chemical species. The fact that the adduct formation is a mode of toxic action, such as occurs in the methylation of DNA during the carcinogenesis, makes adduct measurement as a means of biological monitoring even more pertinent. Adducts to hemoglobin are perhaps the most useful means of biological monitoring by the adduct formation. Hemoglobin is of course present in the blood, which is the most accurate type of sample for biological monitoring. Adducts in the blood plasma albumin are also useful monitor and have been applied to the determination of exposure to the toluene, diisocyanate, benzopyrene, styrene, and styrene oxide and aflatoxin B1. The DNA adduct of styrene oxide has been measured to indicate exposure to carcinogenic styrene oxide.
One disadvantage of biological monitoring by adduct formation can be the relatively complicated procedures and expensive specialized instrument required. Lysine red blood cells may be required to release the hemoglobin adduct. Derivatization may be necessary and the measurements of the final analyte species can require relatively sophisticated instrumental techniques. Despite these complexities, the measurement of hemoglobin adducts is emerging as a method of choice for a number of xenobiotic including acrylamide, acrylonitrile, 1,3-butadiene, 1,3-dichlorobenzidine, ethylene oxide, hexahydrothalic anhydride. Now, the next is the promise of immunological methods. The immunoassay methods offer distinct advantages in specificity, selectivity, simplicity, and cost. Although used in sample test kits for blood glucose and pregnancy testing, immunoassay methods have been limited in biological monitoring of xenobiotics in part because of their inherent advantages. However, it can be anticipated that immunoassays will grow in importance for biological monitoring of xenobiotic. As an example of such an application, polychlorinated biphenyls have been measured in blood plasma by immunoassay method. Immunological techniques can be used for the separation of the analytes from complex biological samples employing immobilized antibodies. This approach has been used to isolate aflatoxicol from urine and enables its determination along with aflatoxins 1, B2, G1, G2, M, I and QI using high performance liquid chromatography and post-column derivatization fluorescence detection. A monoclonal antibody reactive with S-phenyl mercapturic acid, an important phase 2 reaction product of benzene resulting from glutathione conjugation, have been generated from an appropriate heptane protein conjugate. The immobilized antibody has been used in a column to enrich S-phenyl mercapturic acid from the urine of workers exposed to benzene.
So at the last, student, let us summarize what we have learned in this module. So first of all, we have learned about the what is xenobiotics and studies about some xenobiotics and their metabolites forms adducts with endogenous materials in the body, which are then measured as evidence of exposure. Then the analysis of these xenobiotics in different samples, their different extraction procedures and the instrumental techniques used for the identification and the determination of their concentration of xenobiotic compounds in biological material. Thank you so much.